Happy birthday to Marcus Garvey, the father of black nationalism and pan-Africanism. 100 years ago this week, right here in Harlem, Garvey introduced the world to a visible, enduring symbol of black pride, the red, black, and green black liberation flag. Harlem was the main stage from which Marcus Garvey shared his philosophies and opinions, but Garvey's Harlem was much more than that. With a series of interlocking businesses that employed and uplifted people in this community, Garvey's Harlem was a living embodiment of all of his principles. At 2305 7th Avenue, now Adam Clayton Powell Boulevard, Universal Publishing and Printing House was home to the engine that drove the global growth of the UNIA. This was where Negro World newspaper was produced and distributed to all corners of the globe. At 62 West 142nd Street, Universal Steam Laundry and Universal Tailoring and Dressmaking made clothes and uniforms for UNIA and Harlem residents. These businesses were all part of Negro Factories Corporation, which shared offices with the UNIA at 56 West 135th Street. The Black Star Line, Garvey's most ambitious project, also had its offices in Harlem, as well as other businesses including the Phyllis Wheatley Hotel on 136th Street and a motorcade. And the centerpiece of Garvey's activities was Liberty Hall, the UNIA's primary meeting place located next to Abyssinian Baptist Church on 138th Street. The UNIA's activities weren't confined to these buildings. They started the tradition of parades in Harlem that still continue to this day. And when thousands came and marched in suits, dresses, hats, and uniforms, they wore clothes that were made and tailored right in the community. So today we celebrate Marcus Garvey, the man, the message, and the movement.
One of the outstanding images of Marcus Garvey in Harlem is a picture of him on 7th Avenue in a parade. Every time I look at that picture, I say it's the Ralph Lauren ad of its day, because it shows it's not Catfish Row. The architecture in the background could be any imperial city in the world. And so it's telling not only African Americans, but people of African descent in the Caribbean and other places, that there's this cosmopolitan place where we can set an agenda. His parade costume was like an admiral's hat with the feathers. He was from Jamaica, so he was influenced by the English. Whites might have looked at it and said, oh, who does he think he is? But to African Americans and Africans of other places, it kind of said, we can set an agenda.
The teaching of Marcus Garvey. Kebra Negus means glory of kings. Give I and I Selassie and keep the images of lies for yourself. People without a vision perish like suicide. You tell me it's not about color, still you refuse to take the picture off the wall. All you do is trick the brothers and keep them confused. They don't know who to call on in this spiritual war. Now tell me of a paradise in the sky, when that's a lie. And now tell me I was born in sin and shaped in iniquity, when love created I. Look how many prophets tried to open our eyes. You can't fool me. Look how they're treating us, New millennium slavery, hiding the chains and still beating us daily. Now we mentally poisoned to fight with black skin. And bleaching at the inting, far out and far in. Sin, you tell me it's not about color, still you refuse. Take the picture out your books. I know that's not how he looks. Kush. All you do is trick the brothers and keep them confused. They don't know who to call on in this heretical war. Don't tell me of a paradise in the sky, then that's a lie. And not tell me I was born in sin and shaped in iniquity when love created I. Look how many prophets tried to open our eyes. You can't fool me. Gotta mark me, mark me, gotta mark me. Keberanikas means glory of kings. If I and I, Selassie, I keep your images of lies for yourself. People without a vision perish like suicide. You tell me it's not about color, still you refuse. Take the picture off the wall. All you do is trick the brothers and keep them confused. They don't know who to call on in this heretical war. Now tell me of a paradise in the sky, and that's a lie. Don't you tell me I was born in sin and shaped in iniquity and love created I. Look how many prophets tried to open our eyes. Can't fool me. So now tell me of a paradise in the sky, and that's a lie. Now tell me, I was born in sin and shaped in iniquity when Jah created I. Look how many prophets tried. Look how many prophets tried.
A people without knowledge of their past history, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots.
A boy of humble beginnings, taking his first steps towards a life decorated and defined by the search for a proud black identity. The journey began on August 17, 1887, in a rural district nestled in the Garden Parish of St. Anne, where the union of a mason and a domestic worker birthed a living legacy of black self-empowerment.
When you hear him describe his mother, Sarah Jane Garvey, she had a different kind of influence on him. I think that he inherited a lot of her sense of compassion.
Marcus also inherited much from his father, Marcus Mosiah Garvey Sr. Together, his parents gave him a strong foundation, starting at 32 Market Street in St. Anne's Bay. the Universal Negro Improvement Association, the Pan-African Movement, the Negro Factories Corporation, the Black Star Liner Shipping Company, all symbols of achievement to which Garvey could lay claim. But his life was more than the public platform familiar to most. Garvey was equal parts Pan-Africanist and father, equal parts orator and husband, scholar and son, national hero and lifetime student. As a young boy, Garvey developed a love of reading, first from his father's private library and later the more extensive collection of his godfather Alfred Burroughs. An apprenticeship with Burroughs at age 14 provided a platform for literary expression through the printing press. It's an influence that would find expression in several newspaper developments and publications throughout Garvey's life. Even as he trod the path of visionary, philosopher, and scholar, Marcus Garvey was a family man. After a long courtship, he married Amy Ashwood in a private Catholic church ceremony, followed by an elaborate public ceremony and reception at Liberty Hall on Christmas Day, 1919. The union didn't last. But Garvey found love and family life again with his longtime secretary, Amy Jakes. The two married in July 1922 and had two sons, Marcus Jr. and Julius.
You can see letters that they wrote to each other when his sons were in Jamaica and he was in England. He has nicknames for them. He speaks to them the same way a loving father would speak to any child.
From the dirt tracks in a small rural community to a global stage promoting change, the Right Excellent Marcus Mosiah Garvey was the epitome of ambition.
When you look at his background versus what he was able to achieve in a very, very short time period, you have to recognize that it was ambition that was driving him. But most importantly, he had ambition, not just for himself, but for people of his race. He wanted black people to be liberated in every sense of the word, not just physically, but mentally, economically, socially, and so on.
On June 10, 1940, a nation lost a hero. Humanity lost a world changer. Marcus Garvey was finally laid to rest in 1964 in Jamaica after 52 short years. The man from St. Anne's Bay had given black people a new way of looking at themselves. He'd told them to embrace their identity, that they could achieve anything.
Up your mighty race! Accomplish what you will!
The greatest impact of the movement is that it helped to pave the way for Caribbean independence.
This is UCLA Newsweek. In this edition, the Marcus Garvey Archives and new treatment for gut infections. Historian Robert Hill has spent 30 years archiving documents that tell the story of prominent activist Marcus Garvey. In this interview, Hill discusses the significance of the latest edited volume of the Garvey Papers and the importance of the role played by Caribbean members of Garvey's Universal Negro Improvement Association.
Marcus Garvey was the most watched, the most tracked black leader of his time. There was no one whom the governments of the United States, Canada, and Europe felt more concerned about. He was viewed as the most threatening black leader of his time. From the governor of the Panama Canal in reference to Marcus Garvey, comma, Negro agitator, comma. The archive started because I was trying to write a biography of Garvey, but there was so little documentary information that I felt I had to go searching for it. Keeping track of a ton of stuff. it's 11 volumes now of the edited papers and a 12th volume celebrating the centenary of his birth. A total of 15 volumes for the edition when it is complete. See, as I'm looking through this, I'm going Bahamas, British Honduras, Grenada in the Windward Islands, St. Lucia. All of these are reports reflecting very distinctive local divisions of the UNIA. The UNIA stands for Universal Negro Improvement Association. This volume brings now and puts on the table the question of ethnicity. In America, race trumps everything. What's more important is whether you're a Jamaican, Grenadian, Trinidadian, Barbadian, Guyanese, not simply whether you're black. When African Americans began to become active in the Garvey movement in larger and larger numbers, West Indians began to recede. This dialectical changeover is one of the most interesting aspects to try to study. But you will never understand it if you start out by just saying, this is an all-black movement. The greatest impact of the movement is that it helped to pave the way for Caribbean independence. So here is a movement antedating the modern civil rights movement going back to the 1920s, and yet it is the driving force behind the recuperation and the slogans Black Power and Black is Beautiful. I'm trying to return us to an appreciation of this comparative aspect of Garveyism, and see it not just in terms of race, but in terms of its global meaning, its global dynamic. And to do that, we have to overcome this prejudice, this assumption that it was an African-American movement.
No one remember old Marcus Garvey. No one remember old Marcus Garvey. No one remember old Marcus Garvey. Hatred scattered, even melt out of the fire like the
talking about Paul Boger. They've been talking about William Gardner. They've been talking about Norman Washington Manley, including Buster Martin. John D. Baptist said, "Work out, put it away into a salsa." Steven disciples have followed. They stoned him to death.
And now you are in for a very special treat. We're going to go back in time and listen to the person for whom this program is dedicated, to the legendary Marcus Garvey, coming to you in the person of Mr. Ron Bob Semple. Mr. Semple, this is a very special presentation.
Brothers and sisters, good evening. Sisters and brothers, good evening. The black race is one of the branches of the human race. As a section of humanity, he occupies a position in the world at the present time most uncomfortable and most unfavorable. Black people are subjects of ostracism. It is sad that our humanity has shown us no more love, no greater sympathy than we're experiencing. Wheresoever you go throughout the world, the black man is discarded, is ostracized, is relegated to the lowest and things, social, political, and economical. This therefore suggests a problem and one that must be solved. We in this section of the world are not entirely free from this unkind and unsympathetic behavior among the groups or races around us. But since man has been placed on his own responsibility, whether he be black, white, or yellow, he must act in his own account. We will not unduly whine or complain, but reason among ourselves and see what can be done to remedy this state of affairs. Life is a conflict. You have to fight your way through it, whether you will it or not. Those of us who fight most stubbornly live, unto them go the laurels, the palms, and the triumph of our civilization and world. We unfortunately have not been trained to the truths of life, paradoxically so. May I say something to you tonight to give you a true understanding of yourself, so that the same glory and success attained by others who understand themselves would also be yours? Man with the true knowledge of himself is a superb and supreme creature of creation. When Mother Nature created man, she deprived him of nothing. He was given the faculty of understanding all things around him, and that faculty of understanding has not been taken away from him. None of his senses have been taken away from him. So there is no excuse for the black man because of what has been provided for him.
This is Jonathan from the Ethiopian community inviting you to watch African TV 1. Jonathan Bala Loka, Ethiopian Mahabarasab, African TV 1 in the Timelekatu Gabizalo.
Do you know what history means? History is the guidepost of a race. It's the inspiration of future generations either to stand still or go forward, to revenge or be revenged. For 250 years, we heard this cry in the grave, Garvey, we have waited for this day and time. It's not because of how we look. If we must be strong, we must come together. If we must come together, we can only do so through the system of organization. Because the first black heavyweight boxing champion of the world was Jack Johnson. He was a strong man. He was strong wherever he went. He'd beaten his white opponents in Australia. He'd beaten them in the United States. And he could beat them wherever they presented themselves. The African race could be like Jack Johnson. If it is strong in Africa, then it could be strong everywhere. For 250 years, we have struggled under the burden and rigors of slavery. We were maimed. We were brutalized. We were ravaged in every way. We are men. We have hopes. We have passions. We have feelings. We have desires just like any other race. The cries raised all over the world of Canada for the Canadians, of America for the Americans, of England for English, of France for the French, of Germany for the Germans. Do you think it unreasonable that we, the blacks of the world, should raise a cry of Africa for the Africans? The Negro is a man. We represent the new Negro. His back is not yet against the wall. We do not want his back against the wall because that would be a peculiar and desperate position. We do not want him there. It's because of this that we are asking for a fair compromise. Where the Belgians have control of the Belgian Congo, which they cannot use. They have not the resources to develop, nor the intelligence. The French have more territory than they can develop. There are certain parts of Africa in which you cannot live at all. So it is for you to come together and give us a United States of Africa.
My name is Malik White, and you're watching Africa TV 1.
Je suis Baldé Aboubakar, je suis le président de l'association des Guinéens des États-Unis, en même temps président de l'association des Guinéens d'Atlanta. Je vous invite tous à supporter et à regarder Africa TV One pour le bien-être et l'éducation et l'information de tout le monde. Again in English, I'm Aboubakar Baldé, the president of the Guinean Association in America. I invite all of us to support and watch Africa TV.
We are not going to be a race without a country. God never intended it, and we are not going to abuse God's confidence in us as men. We are men, human beings, capable of the same acts as any other race, possessing under fair circumstances the same intelligence as any other race. Africa has been sleeping, not dead, only sleeping. Today, Africa is walking around not only on our feet, but on our brains. You can enslave as were done for 300 years, the bodies of men. You can shackle the hands of men. You can shackle the feet of men. You can imprison the bodies of men. But you cannot shackle or imprison the minds of men. Dive down, black men, and dig. Reach out, black men and women, and pull all nature's knowledge to you. Turn you around and make a conquest of everything, north and south, east and west, and then when you will have wrought well, you will have merited God's blessings. And as you bow down to the white man today, so will other races bow down to you and call you a race of masters because of the superiority of your minds and your achievements. God made man lord of his creation, gave him possession and ownership on the world. And you have been so darn lazy that you've allowed the other fellow to run away with the whole world, and now he's bluffing you and telling you that the world belongs to him and that you have no part in it. I don't have to apologize to anybody for being black, because God Almighty knew exactly what he was doing when he made me black. You race of cowards, you race of imbeciles, you race of good-for-nothings. If you cannot do what other nations have done, what other races have done, then you had better die. Can we do it?
Yeah.
We can do it.
Yeah, we can.
Because any leadership that teaches you to depend upon another race is a leadership that will enslave you.
Yeah.
Let me say that again. Any leadership that teaches you to depend upon another race is a leadership that will enslave you. They gave leadership to our four parents, and that leadership made them slaves. But we've decided to find a leadership of our own to make ourselves free men. Babylon did it. Assyria did it. France under Napoleon did it. Britain under William Pitt, Earl of Chatham did it. America under George Washington did it. Africa with 400 million black people can do it. If you cannot do it, if you are not prepared to do it, then you had better die. Because when the history of mine is complete, future generations shall have in their hands the guide by which they shall know the sins of your 20th century. I know, and I know you too believe in time, but we shall wait patiently for 200 years, if need be, to face our enemies through our posterity. In life I shall be the same, in death I shall be a terror to the foes of African liberty. If death has power, then count on me to be the real Marcus Garvey I would like to be. If I may come in a plague or a pestilence, or as God would have me, then be assured that I shall never desert you and make your enemies triumph over you. Will I not go to hell a million times for you? If I die in Atlanta, my work shall only just begin. But I shall live in the physical or the spiritual to see the day of Africa's glory. Look for me in the world when there's a storm. Look for me all around you. For God's grace and blessings, I shall come back and bring with me countless millions of black men and women who have died in America, who have died in the West Indies, and who have died in Africa to aid you in the life for liberty, freedom, and life. The world today has gone drunk and crazy with its power. And by such true injustice, fraud, and lies have crushed the unfortunate. But if I'm apparently crushed by the system of influence and misdirected power, my cause shall rise again to plague the conscience of the corrupt. For this I'm happy to suffer and even die. For I will write the history of the millions that are coming, and leave to posterity to reckon with a host for the deeds of their fathers. If others laugh at you, return the laughter to them. If they honor you, return the compliment with equal force. They have no more right to dishonor, disrespect, and disregard your feeling and manhood than you have in dealing with them. Honor them when they honor you. Disrespect and disregard them when they vilely treat you. Their arrogance is but skin deep, assumption that has no foundation in morals or in law. But they have sprung from the same family tree of obscurity as we have. Their history is as rude in its primitiveness as ours. When they were embracing the arts and sciences on the banks of the Nile, their ancestors were drinking blood out of the skulls of the human dead and eating raw meat from wild beasts for centuries, even as they have accused us of doing. Their cannibalism was more prolonged than ours. When we had reached the noonday of progress, they were still living in holes with bats, rats, and other insects and animals. After we had unfathomed the mystery of the stars and reduced the heavenly constellation to minute and regular calculus, they were still backwards men living in ignorance and in blatant darkness. The world today is indebted to us for the benefits of civilization. They stole our arts and sciences from Africa. So why should we be ashamed of ourselves?
My name is Malik White, and you're watching Africa TV One.
Like the great Church of Rome, black people the whole world over should practice one faith, and that of confidence in themselves, with one God, one aim, and one destiny. Because we are the descendants of a suffering people. We are the descendants of a people determined to suffer no longer. Many men and women, as black as I am, and even more so, had believed themselves white under the West Indian order of society. I was simply an impossible man to use openly the term Negro, yet everyone beneath his breath was calling the black man a nigger. I had to decide whether to please my friends and be one of the black whites of Jamaica and be reasonably prosperous, or come out openly and help improve and protect the integrity of the black millions and suffer. I decided to do the latter. There is no future for people who deny their past. My foreparents, my grandparents, my mother, my father did not suffer and die to give me an education to slight, oppress, or discourage my people. Whatsoever education I acquired out of their sacrifice of over 300 years, I shall use for the salvation of the 400 million black people of the world. And the day when I forsake my people, may God Almighty say, there shall be no more light for you. I unequivocally rejected the racist assumption of much white American Christianity, namely that God had created the black man inferior and that he'd intended Negroes to be a servant class, hewers of wood and drawers of water. I predicated my view of the man on doctrines of imago Dei. All men, regardless of color, are created in the image of God. From this premise followed equality of all men and the brotherhood of all men. The biblical injunction of Acts 17:26 reminds you that he created of one blood all nations of men to dwell on the face of the earth. Well, I was most interested in brotherhood within his own race. Because if Negroes are created in God's image and Negroes are black, then God must, in some sense, be black. If the white man has an idea of a white God, let him worship his God as he desires. We have found a new ideal. Because whilst our God has no color, and yet it is human to see everything through one's own spectacles, and since the white people have seen their God through their white spectacles, we have only now started to see our God through our own spectacles. But we believe in the God of Ethiopia, the everlasting God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, the one God of all ages. That is the God in whom we believe. But we shall worship him through the spectacles of Ethiopia. Do you know what it is to be a man? To be a man is to bear resemblance of the Creator, the image of the Creator. If you are conscious of the fact that you bear the image of the Creator, then you are a man. Man is a religious being. You may be a Christian. You may be a Mohammedan. You may be a Rastaman. That is your religion. We are entitled to our own religious beliefs. Because the white world has always tried to rob and discredit us of our history. They tell us that Tutankhamun, the king that reigned about the year 1350 BC, was not a black man. That the ancient civilization and the pharaohs was not of our race. But that does not make the truth unreal. Because many students of impartial mind know that we once ruled the world. When white men were barbarians and savages living in caves, thousands of our professionals at that time taught in the universities of Alexandria, then the seat of learning. No black man shall be truly respected until the race as a whole has emancipated itself to self-achievement and progress from universal prejudice. Back in the days of slavery, race mixture and miscegenation had occurred because the African woman had no protection from the slave master. So there is no need today for black people to themselves freely continue a practice that smacked so much of slavery. Black people should see beauty in their own kind and not try to bleach their skins and be otherwise than what they are. One of our problems historically is that we've always been reacting. Reacting to initiatives taken by other people. You cannot depend upon another race to free you. That's a basic law of human existence. Because I came into the Caucasian culture at a time when the white man still had a need for the black man's labor. I preached and penetrated the black man's consciousness to such a degree that the white man felt threatened by me demanding and commanding so much black time and attention. Whites find it hard to sit idly by and see this black man take their slave labor away, especially back to Africa. Who then would bear the white man's burden? But I believe that my blood shall pay the remission for which future generations of our race shall be declared free. Freedom of opportunity, freedom of action are things that we need. Because vile thoughts bring to vile people in vile times. You could not tell me in the 1920s that 90 years later, this world would be infested with neutron bombs, AIDS, homelessness, terrorism, laser beams, and visible nuclear devastation. However, were I alive today, I would still ask for my people's upliftment, self-esteem, self-respect, in a world gone crazy with individualism. I never taught racism, but rather pride and dignity in one's race. With God's dearest blessings, I'll leave you for a while. One love.
Marcus Garvey, children, it is time to know more about Marcus Mosiah Garvey.
And African Communities League of the World. You may ask, what organization is that? It is for me to inform you that the Universal Negro Improvement Association is an organization that seeks to unite into one solid body the 400 million Negroes of the world, to link up the 15 million Negroes of the United States of America with the 20 million Negroes of the West Indies, the 40 million Negroes of South and Central America with the 280 million Negroes of Africa, for the purpose of bettering our industrial, commercial, educational, social, and political conditions. As you are aware, the world in which we live today is divided into separate race groups and distinct nationalities. Each race and each nationality is endeavoring to work out its own destiny to the exclusion of other races and other nationalities. We hear the cry of England for the Englishman, of France for the Frenchman, of Germany for the German, of Ireland for the Irish, of Palestine for the Jew, of Japan for the Japanese, of China for the Chinese. We of the Universal Negro Movement Association are raising the cry of Africa for the Africans, those at home and those abroad. There are 400 million Africans in the world who have Negro blood coursing through their veins, and we believe that the time has come to unite these 400 million people for the one common purpose of bettering their conditions. The great problem of the Negro for the last 500 years has been that of disunity. No one or no organization ever succeeded in uniting the Negro race. But within the last 4 years, the Universal Negro Improvement Association has worked wonders in bringing together in one fold 4 million organized Negroes who are scattered in all parts of the world, being in the 48 states of the American Union, all the West Indian Islands, and the countries of South and Central America and Africa. These 4 million people are working to convert the rest of the 400 million scattered all over the world. And it is for this purpose that we are asking you to join our ranks and to do the best you can to help us to bring about an emancipated race. If anything praiseworthy is to be done, it must be done through unity. And it is for that reason that the Universal Negro Improvement Association calls upon every Negro in the United States to rally to this standard. We want to unite the Negro race in this country. We want every Negro to work for one common object, that of building a nation of his own on the great continent of Africa. That all Negroes all over the world are working for the establishment of a government in Africa means that it will be realized in another few years. We want the moral and financial support of every Negro to make the dream a possibility. Already, this organization has established itself in Liberia, West Africa, and is endeavoring to do all possible to develop that Negro country to become a great industrial and commercial commonwealth. Pioneers have been sent by this organization to Liberia, and they are now laying the foundations upon which the 400 million Negroes of the world will build. If you believe that the Negro has a soul, if you believe that the Negro is a man, if you believe the Negro was endowed with the senses commonly given to other men by the Creator, Then you must acknowledge that whatever men have done, Negroes can do. We want to build up cities, nations, governments, industries of our own in Africa so that we'll be able to have a chance to rise from the lowest to the highest positions in the African Commonwealth.
On the morning of August 3rd, 1920, 46-year-old Jacob Mills shined his boots, polished his sword, and headed to Harlem to take part in one of the biggest parades in New York's history.
As a young boy, to see my father in the parade was one of the greatest things in the world. I would be right there to see him put on his tunic, and I loved to see that sword that he carried. It really made me feel very proud of him.
Mills was one of 100,000 black people marching under the red, black, and green flag of the Universal Negro Improvement Association. The world had never seen anything like it. It was all the work of one man, Marcus Garvey.
Every window that you looked at, people's heads were out to see the Marcus Garvey parade. Most of them wanted to see Marcus Garvey. And he was very well decorated, his hats and the feathers, but he drove always in his automobile, sitting back.
At the age of 34, Garvey claimed millions of followers worldwide. His controversial goal, to create an independent black nation, made him one of the most powerful people in America and one of the most hated. The federal government targeted him as a threat to national security. Rival black leaders denounced him as a lunatic and a traitor to the race. But Garvey may have been his own worst enemy.
He wasn't one to take advice from others kindly. He made his own decisions, and he would rise or fall by the decisions that he made, because he was a supreme egotist.
Volatile and secretive, yet charismatic and visionary, Marcus Garvey changed forever the way black Americans looked at themselves and the world.
He started something that became bigger than Garvey himself. He, more than any other figure in the 20th century, symbolizes the turning of the perception of black people into something positive. Garvey's father was a mason, a professional mason. And among the things that he did was to create tombs for people in the St. Anne's Bay graveyard. He took Garvey with him to the graveyard one day, and they were digging this grave, and his father had Garvey go down inside the grave, but then he pulled the ladder up and left the child in the bottom of the grave. Garvey said that he cried out and his father wouldn't let him get back up out of the grave. He wanted to teach him a lesson.
Alone in the grave, young Marcus Garvey learned that he could rely on no one but himself. It was a lesson he would carry for the rest of his life. Thank you. Marcus Garvey was born in August of 1887 in St. Anne's Bay, a small town on the northern coast of Jamaica. His father, who had been born a slave, withdrew from the family for days at a time and insisted his wife and two children address him at all times as Mr. Garvey.
My grandfather was a very stubborn man who had to have his way, who he was quite retiring to. He used to, the strange thing about him, he used to have his own little apartment off the main house where they lived. And he would be by himself there, reading a lot. Now, if you look at it, the thing, Marcus Garvey was like that himself too. He liked to be by himself.
Marcus obviously inherited many of his characteristics. Marcus Garvey's father was repressed in many ways, a frustrated person, a person who could find no way out and seemed to have internalized much of the feeling that the world was against him.
Garvey's mother raised crops and, like many women of her time, cooked for a white family to support her own. But Sarah Jane Richards wanted more for her only surviving son than a life of common labor in the banana fields.
Garvey's mother had a tremendous influence upon him, and she had great hopes for him. She wanted, in fact, to call him Moses. And she thought that he was going to do great things. That source of love, that someone, his mother in particular, loved him, helped to create that extraordinary self-confidence that Garvey had.
As a boy, Garvey imagined himself delivering speeches to adoring crowds. He spent hours reading, and even bet his friends they couldn't pick a single word from the dictionary that he didn't know.
The young Garvey had ambition. He wanted to get out of St. Anne's Bay. Later he said he dreamt of becoming the first gentleman in the world. And it seemed as if he early on developed this interest in a kind of dramatic, epic story of himself in which he would play a leading part.
But Garvey's grand ambitions were tempered by reality. As children, blacks and whites mixed easily in his community. One of his closest friends was a white neighbor, Joyce Reary. But as they became teenagers, her father put an end to the friendship.
At the age of 14, she was sent away to England and told never to speak to him because he was a nigger. And he said that's the first time that he heard and became aware of this idea of being black and what it meant. He felt shut out. He felt that he was excluded and made to feel that he was not good enough. And the rest of his life was really an attempt to prove that he was just as good as anyone else in the world.
Under the colonial education system, Garvey was forced to leave school at the age of 14. He became a printer's apprentice and quickly earned the status of master printer. In the print shop, he learned the power of controlling the written word and would soon publish his first newspaper, Garvey's Watchman. In 1910, 23-year-old Marcus Garvey set out on a journey through Central America. Supporting himself as a journalist and laborer, Garvey saw black workers harvesting plantations, loading ships, and building the Panama Canal. They were the power behind the economy. But in their isolation from each other, black people were powerless. In 1914, he came upon the book that would change his life.
Marcus Garvey's reading of Booker T. Washington's Up From Slavery was an eye-opener to him and pointed the way to his conclusion, which remained with him throughout his life, that the situation facing black people was a global one.
I was determined that the black man would not continue to be kicked about, as I had seen in Central America and as I had read of it in America. Where is the black man's government? Where is his king and his kingdom? Where is his president, his country, his men of big affairs? I could not find them. And then I declared, I will help to make them. My brain was afire.
As he sailed for home, Garvey's grand vision for himself and for the world clicked into place. He would unify black people scattered across the globe, and he would be their leader. Back in Kingston, he attended a debate and noticed an attractive 17-year-old named Amy Ashwood. When Ashwood took to the stage and delivered a powerful political speech, Garvey knew he had found a kindred spirit. He approached her later that evening as they rode home on a trolley. "At last I have met the star of my destiny," Garvey exclaimed.
Her parents were very opposed to it, particularly her mother, who was trying to keep her away from Garvey because Garvey didn't seem to have a solid income or be the type of person that she wanted her daughter dating. But Garvey was a great romantic, and he announced to Ashwood that she was his Josephine.
And she says, "If you are my Napoleon," and they make a pledge that they would remain together and forge what would become the Universal Negro Improvement Association, and they launch it together in August of 1914.
With the motto, "One God, One Aim, One Destiny," the Universal Negro Improvement Association stressed race pride and sought backers for an industrial training school, modeled on Booker T. Washington's Tuskegee Institute. Garvey and Ashwood attracted a small, loyal following, but there was trouble from the beginning. Garvey created enemies by attacking established leaders. He wouldn't tolerate the slightest dissent from UNIA members, and he was a disastrous money manager, using contributions to the school to pay for his own living expenses. When his few supporters clamored for an accounting, 29-year-old Garvey decided to leave town. He hired himself out on the crew of the SS Talloc, and in the spring of 1916, he left Amy Ashwood behind and set sail alone for New York City. His ideas had failed in Jamaica, but they would find new life in America.
When Garvey comes to the United States, Harlem is a throbbing, bubbling, exciting place. These are fantastic buildings, apartments. The street life is abundant. This is a fast-moving and a very affluent world.